Welcome to the newest podcast, Two Stupid Freaking Guys. I'm your co-host, producer, punching bag to my buddy John, Tommy Maloney. Do you like the music? John challenged me. He said, hey, we need a little music. So here we go. I hope you like. I figured since we talk a lot about radio stories, why not have Queen and Radio Gaga? It is pouring rain here in Dodge City, Kansas. And we had hail last night. And I said to one of my coworkers, I said, man, I was a little concerned about the rental car. He looks at me and goes, it's insured. Don't worry about it. I'm like, oh, yeah. Okay. Wow. So we just finished up recording episode 2. And I think we're starting to get the feel of where we are. Want to start going with this podcast. And if this is your first time listening, again, I'm Tommy. You'll be listening to John, who the two of us used to work together in radio. And because we still talk about this, and not on this episode, but we will. But because John took a bigger, as we would say in the biz, a bigger gig, I got stuck at the radio station he and I were working at, and they eventually fired me. And then, ironically, John ended up getting fired. And so I hate to be a person of regrets, but this is one of those regrets that he and I have talked about for many, many years, is that when we worked together, that we were on the potential of really creating something. And I know this podcast is going to take a while, but I really felt after this episode, this is where the two of us are starting to get that chemistry back, get that creativity back. One thing's when he and I worked together, I stayed away from being on air. I was more behind the scenes, but this is something I've wanted to do as well a long time, of just being a part of something, being having a little tandem, so to speak. So anyway, on this episode, we're going to talk about, among other things, and if you listen to the first episode, John's going through a divorce right now, and we talk about, if you've ever listened to Eddie, I think it was Eddie Murphy's Raw comedy, and all he had to say was, half. So we're going to talk about half. We're also going to talk about something that came up, ADD and ADHD. And of course, being two former radio guys, we lay into our old radio stories. So there you go. Episode 2, Two Stupid Freaking Guys. I hope you enjoy it. I'm honestly, this has been a lot of fun. And again, there's so much potential in this podcast. Eventually, we're going to take it off this platform, the Blending the Family platform, and we're going to put it on our own area. I don't know what to call it. But anyway, thank you for listening. I hope you enjoy it. If you have any topics you want us to talk about, we are very open. Just shoot me an email at tommy@blendingthefamily.com. That's tommy@blendingthefamily.com. There you go. I'm going to have to play a little more Queen. Radio Goo Goo, Radio Gaga.
All we hear is Radio Gaga. Radio
can't hear you. There's nothing coming through. There's nothing coming through. You're like, did you know I do 52 different languages in sign language? I can't hear you now. I can read your fucking lips, you jackass. Come on. It's not, nothing's coming. Oh, there, I heard something. You breathed or you farted. I'm not really sure which hole came out. But
what about now? Something. Now?
Now I hear you now.
Okay. Jesus. Yeah, this proves I can't do this from a hotel.
Oh, it sucks balls. Oh, well, we can do it Saturday. I'm up for it. I got some topics. I got some good topics. Looking for a truck is an old guy thing. I got never force yourself to do anything uncomfortable. marriage or hookers? Which is a better investment? Impulsive buys, stupid things you've done to get a job, or stupid things you did, and that's the reason you didn't get a job. So I think
I can. Hold on. Let me get some water.
Don't pee in a cup and drink it. That's not healthy. Kevin Costner tried that on some movie.
There we go. Hold on.
Isn't hotel life awesome? Especially in the remote part of the world. You might as well be in fucking Alaska underwater.
I love Alaska. That's when my phone's. Phrase the job one again.
Stupid things you did to get a job, or something stupid you did that didn't get you the job.
Oh God! So when I first moved to Denver, I was trying to get a job at one of the radio stations there. So I went to a place and had my resume blown up like the size of a blueprint.
Yeah.
And hand delivered it to the radio station. Nice. Never heard back.
Really? Heard back. That sucks. Yeah. I think that's really creative. You would have thought that they would have even called you and said, hey, that's creative. Nice job.
Yeah. I mean, but do you know how I sort of got the job in Cookeville?
I sent
Scott a video.
Of your sack?
Sort of. I was sitting on Santa's lap.
What was the picture? What was the video of?
So he made this video because at the time I was working for a production company.
Yeah.
And we had the Santa's workshop and the photo booth and all that shit.
Oh, cool.
So one of the times I said, I'm going to try something. So I made a video of me sitting on Santa's lap asking all I want for Christmas was a job in radio.
Nice.
And a buddy of mine worked at a
brothel.
What do you call it?
A brothel?
No. Shit.
And he said, Tommy, come in the rear. Pass me the note.
No,
it'll be all good. Yeah,
a place where they could duplicate videotapes, and so he made me. They were expensive, but he made me like 10 of them.
Oh, nice.
I sent them out, and yeah, that's kind of how I got the a call from Kick 106.9.
Was it Bill that called you, or was it Scott?
Scott.
Hi, it's Scott. I'm Tommy. We'd like to hire you to work on the morning show. I know I sound like a female, but you know, sometimes I'm still going through puberty now.
Oh, hold on. I'll put a little growl in there so I sound like a real radio guy.
So there you go. There's my stupid radio ones.
Cool. That's good. And I closed in the house today. I refinanced the house. So now they're going to give my ex-wife $25,000 because I had to give her half the equity in the house, which is painful as hell. I'm like, oh, my God. And then, of course, child support every month. You know, oh, it's ridiculous. I shouldn't have to pay anything. I did nothing.
How does that work out?
It doesn't. I mean... So I decided to stay in the house. Well, we can talk about it on the episode, you know, Saturday.
We're talking about it right now.
It's not recording though, right?
Yeah, it is.
You said it wasn't working.
It's working.
Oh,
that's why I talked about the stupid shit about the radio jobs.
Oh, Jesus Christ! What were we talking about now?
So you're staying in the house.
I'm staying in the house. She moved out. She got her own house. And so what happens is, you know, because you're married for 16 years, she gets half of whatever you have as far as.
You have half of nothing. What's half of nothing? Nothing.
Right. Well, so if you have debt, You also get half of that. So I got half the debt, which she had two monster credit cards. One was $11,000. She took that one. I got the one for $9,900. Then I got the Macy's, and I also got the Target. And let me let you in on a little something. I never used any of those credit cards once in our 15, 16-year marriage. It was a joke. I'm like, I got to pay that, yet I never have ever used either of those cards. Now, I will say this. We did go on some family vacations. The one, I think the Disney vacation was on the one card. So, and that's going to take another million years to pay off. But, you know, we just didn't pay it off. Like, so when we first got married, I think it, like 5 years into it, we ended up paying off $30,000 of her debt. And then again, she accumulated all this debt because she likes to shop. She's got more pairs of boots than Mel DeMarcos. But oh my God. Yeah. She's a fashion queen. I mean, she's a beautiful woman, but oh my God, the beauty products, getting her hair done every other week. See, that's why I'm thinking we should talk about marriage or hookers. What's a better investment? I'm thinking I've talked to a couple of guys who've done a poll and I think it's cheaper.
Hold on. The guys have done the poll. Guys have been on the poll.
No, not the girls.
Yeah. Who's been on the poll?
Okay, let me say, I did a survey of a couple of guys after talking to one guy. He goes, yeah, my friend. He says, screw it. He's never getting married again. He just gets hookers. So he goes, so he has a date every, you know, once a month. He goes, he figures it's a lot cheaper than having her go out and buy, shop, travel, eat lunches with all her friends. He goes, it's a lot cheaper just to get a hooker every once in a while than it is to actually get married, which I'm almost thinking I would have to agree with that.
That's like Charlie Sheen's character on Two and a Half Men. When that's all he ever did was he just had hookers.
Hookers. I'm thinking that might be a good thing. Oh, did I tell you about the one time?
Had a hooker?
Well.
Or you were a hooker. You were a hooker. I remember that.
Yeah, I was a hooker. Yeah. I hooked. No, there was a radio station that I worked at. That was part of the interview process. So it was me.
What? Keep going. This is going to be interesting.
So I flew down to Mississippi. I don't think I should say the town because in case somebody hears this and somebody will get in trouble. Although the place shut down, so I don't think anybody will get in trouble. But so I went down.
Does it begin with an M?
Yeah, Meridian, Mississippi. So I went.
So don't say it.
Oh, so I went down there, and part of the interview process was I'd been up north all my life, so I went down south to Meridian, Mississippi. You talk about a totally different world. I learned a lot about Mississippi, though. It's the place and home. Meridian, Mississippi is, you know, the home of Jimmy Rogers, the supposed father of country music. And then
Little Jimmy Rogers?
No, it's just Jimmy Rogers. Oh. You're thinking of Little Jimmy Dickey.
Yes.
Yeah. I actually saw him in Nashville at one time. But back to the story. So back to the hooker story. So it wasn't really hookers. I don't know if you call them hookers when you go to a brothel. Do you call them servants or ladies of the night? So we're driving around, and this is on a Sunday. And I had gone down to this radio station for an interview. And I flew down from Lincoln, Nebraska on a Friday. And I go out and we're kind of hanging out. And these guys were like, hey, man, this guy decide what he wants to do. Does he want to take the job? Has he made up his mind? So we're driving around in this big Cadillac on a Sunday. It's me, the consultant, the program director, and the station owner. It was a kid. It was the dad bought the radio station for his son. Great radio station. It had 100,000 watts of power, could reach the coast and everything. It was pretty impressive. They spent a lot of money on liners and stuff. The station sounded great. They had processing up the yin-yang back in that day that was really cool, you know. So we're driving around on Sunday in the Cadillac, and they're like, hey, man, has the guy made up his mind yet? Hey, Doc. The owner's name was Dean Pierce. Dean was about 6'8", 310 pounds, and a big old lanky dude. Really nice guy and funny as hell. So we're driving around and they go, hey, is he made up his mind? And I, and they're like, hey. They go, Murph, what do you think? And I'm like, I don't know. They're like, all right. Hey, should we all go to Ma Shoemates? So there's a place called Ma Shoemates, and this is where the girls were. And I'm like, and this is on a Sunday. Keep in mind, we're drinking beer at 10 in the morning, driving around in a Cadillac on a Sunday, and they're trying to talk me into taking this job. So I'm like, oh my God, I don't know. I was scared out of my mind because I'd never been down south before, and Meridian is like the deep south, and
right,
you know, down there they're like, man, you ain't from around here, is you? You kind of talk fast. And I'm like, yeah, you're right. I'm not from around here. So they're driving around. They're going, all right, let's go to Ma Shoemates. And I'm like, what is Ma Shoemates? They go, well, It's a whorehouse. I'm like, oh my God. I was like, you know, growing up, you hear about them, you don't think they're real. You're like, they actually got those? I'm like, oh my God, we're going to go to a whorehouse. I'm like, oh Jesus. So we end up going there and we walk in and you talk about scary. There's all these guys in their hunting gear, camouflage stuff, and they got machetes on the side of their belts. And I'm like, oh my God, I'm either going to die in here or I might even get laid.
Or both.
So we go in there and these guys didn't know anything about it either. Evidently they had never been. So they asked the waitress, she comes over, she goes, hey, what are you guys here for? They go, well, we would like a drink. And what would it take to get an F and a, well, how can I say this? Fucking a suck. For all of us, and get this, the consultant goes, for $50, could we all like, oh my God, there's like five guys.
Oh my gosh.
She goes, no, that's not the way it works. She goes, it's $150 for each and it's cash. And how it works is you pay me the $150, and they're all like, oh my God. They're like, oh Jesus, it's gonna be a lot. They're like, all right, let's do it. So they go ahead and they go, all right, we're gonna pay you the money. How does this work? What do we do? And we're like little kids, and you're scared out of your mind going, some cop gonna bust in the back door or whatever. So go back there. And she goes, all right, $150. So we pay her $150. And, you know, the one program director has like wads of cash. He whips out this roll. It had to be about 6 inches thick. I'm like, Jesus, what does this guy do for a living? So whips out, pays her. And he goes, all right, we're going to do the whole deal. And we're like, how does this work? So she goes, well, you go up to the bar and you pick the girl that you like. And point her out and say, that's the girl I want. So then what they do is you then meet the girl, and they're almost like mobile homes that are attached to this bar out back. So you go walking in the back and you meet the girl or whatever. So I won't get too much into it, but they do wash you off so you're clean. And then she goes, so what do you want? And I'm like,
to go home?
Yeah, I'm like, you know, I'm like, I'm still kind of like scared because I'm like, I don't know what the hell is going on. I'm like, never. And you're in the deep south, so it is a little scary because you're not familiar with it. So I go, she goes, well, what do you want? I go, just pretend you like it. She got like so mad. Shut up, you idiot. And afterwards, she goes, you know, I wouldn't mind dating you. And I'm like, let me think about that one. I don't think that would be a good idea.
Gotta go, bye.
So needless to say, I took the job.
Oh my gosh.
That was the best interview story I ever had. And that, nobody ever believes it, but it was amazing. I was like, it's scary, but amazing. I mean, so top that one.
Household or your so
oh
so
yeah
how are you so, but how are you doing? I mean,
I'm doing good because I'm super busy with work.
Right.
And I trying to be more focused. I'm trying to be a better me. You know, all that corny bullshit that you hear. So what does that mean though? I don't be, you know, more efficient, make more money, be better with my time. You know, I have ADD, so you can, you know, I see something flashy and I'm turning my head. I've had ADD all my life and I never really even knew it until John Mark, my son, was diagnosed with it. And then my daughter Ava was diagnosed with it. And I go, you know what? I bet I've got that. But I was drinking so much Diet Coke and so much caffeine that it kind of leveled out, because what happens is you drink that and your mind actually slows down. So caffeine actually kind of almost has the opposite effect on your mind when you have ADD. So that's why when they give you the Adderall or whatever
medication you're on. Are you taking meds?
Oh, yeah, man. I'm on it. Yeah, I do. I take it so I can focus. Basically what it is, you take it so you can focus, so you can get through something. So what's really hard for me is to stay focused on one task, especially in my job where I do sales and I have to do paperwork. That is like the most painful thing in the world for me to sit still and do that. Like being outside in front of the customer, having fun, talking to the customer, goofing around is great. But it's the daily tasks of reporting in your sales reporting tool, all that stuff to me is super boring. So if you know anything about ADD, if you're not really interested in it, your attention span is like that. I mean, you're 2 seconds and you're done. Like, so I really like working on cars so I can focus on that and do that for a long time. And there's also the opposite effect. So when you're so into it, you almost become obsessed with it. You can do it for hours and not even realize that you've been doing it for 10 hours or whatever. And they're like, oh my God, look at the time. Holy cow, it's 3 a.m. I didn't know it was 3 a.m. But so you got to be careful with that. The medication, the thing is, it's like super caffeine. So you take that, and then if you drink a bunch of coffee, man, you will be sweating like crazy. You'll be pitting out. You'll be like, oh my God, like your heart will start racing. So you got to be a little careful with it. You know, I try not to drink as much caffeine, but you know, being in radio, I was always drinking so much caffeine. You're kind of almost addicted to it and you're used to it, that caffeine high. So,
well, back when we were working together, cause I did the overnights and then our morning show. So I was going through probably 2 pots of coffee, and there was one time I thought I was just going to throw up on the air because I had had so much coffee, and I'm just like, oh, God, what am I doing?
Yeah.
But, you know.
Do you have ADD?
You know, that's – I don't know.
So there's a couple ways to tell.
My son has it.
Well, then you probably have it too, honestly.
No, I don't.
Yeah, you do. Because you always grew up, so here's a little test. So in class, during school, did you always think you were stupid?
Yeah, I still do.
Well,
but that's part of it.
People who have ADD always thought they were dumber than the other people. You always felt like you had to work harder in school to achieve maybe a C or a B. You knew you had to work harder than they did. You just knew it, but you probably coped with it. You were able to develop some kind of coping mechanism, and that's typically what happens. Like for me, I just drank a lot of Diet Coke and I kind of balanced it out or whatever.
But I just went home and cried. That's it. You know, it worked out fine for me. Well, I mean, the one-liner you did where it was about the math tutor I had in high school. And the math tutor, he really did. He told me I was too dumb to have a math tutor. And so it was
too dumb. What a great tutor.
He said, yeah, I know. And it hurt because I really wanted to excel at math. And, you know, after that, I was just like, all right, fine. So I've trained myself, unfortunately, to say to people, I'm not good at math.
Yeah, see, you probably have ADD because that's one of the symptoms is people think they're dumb. And you think, like, I was never good at math. And my daughter, that Ava, but has ADD, good at math. But my son, John Mark, is awesome at math. And he's got ADD. So it's, I don't know. I think it's hit and miss.
Well, it was funny because recently I was going through a job interview process and I had to take, oh my gosh, I had to go through three rounds of online testing.
Oh,
and
God.
One of them was math. And I'm like,
You always get intimidated by it, don't you? You're like,
I do. You know. I do. But I somehow I passed. I don't know how I passed, but
nice.
I have no idea where we're going with this. But I know why. Part of me disagrees with you is only because, I look back at, you know, my parents were divorced. I didn't have a solid relationship with my dad, so of course ingrained in me was probably a little bit of abandonment issues. And that's probably why I had, you know, low self-esteem and felt like an idiot in class because I was just like not interested.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, no, stuff that you're really interested in, though, you're probably hyper-focused on it. You can actually go to somebody and they'll give you like a 2-page questionnaire and it'll tell you if you have ADD, ADHD. They'll know right away. So what happens is you take a series of questions. There's probably like 24 questions. And then the guy grades it and he goes, all right, if you get 7 or more, you obviously have ADD. I think I had like 14 of them. He goes, yep, you got it.
So then do you think that's is that a fair way to diagnose it?
I guess. I mean, but did you know that a lot of golfers actually take ADD medication? They falsify the test or somebody gets them in and gets them some kind of prescription for it. Because what happens is you're really able to focus. So what I do when I'm going to play golf with some customers or whatever, I'll take an extra dose of it and I will play much better. I can really focus. I swear to God, right. It works. So I see why they take it. It helps them to focus, and especially with
What? I wish I had known that years ago when I played golf with you, and I ended up breaking that club because you pissed me off so bad.
Why did you get mad? What was the deal?
Because we were laughing at you. Picking on me and something, and I just—it was a bad day, and I'm just like, "Fuck this!" And I threw a club and ended up breaking the club.
Well, you know, with you, you're one of those guys that is fun to make fun of and easy to make fun of, and you take it well. But a lot of times what I notice is that after so much, you're like, all right. And then you just lose it. And you start screaming and throwing stuff. I can't take it. It's kind of like, so in Cookeville, when we were at the radio station in Cookeville, I told Bill Penn, who was the programmer.
You're not telling that story. You're telling that story.
And I go, Bill, I got to tell you something. But Tommy really stinks. I go, oh, my God. I go, he's got, like, the worst BO. I go, I kind of understand because he's working overnights and then he's also working the morning show. I go, but he stinks. He goes, oh, do you want me to say anything? I go, no, don't say anything. And then 2 minutes later, he calls you in, Tommy. And then he closes the door. And you could tell me what he said because I don't know. And all I heard was you screaming, I can't play that jerk. You're like going nuts in his office. So what did he say to you?
All right. So you're telling that story. I can't believe you're telling that story. Anyway.
It was a funny story.
I had gone to Chicago back home for the weekend. My flight, because I was still working the overnight. So it was a Sunday. And so I went right from Nashville Airport right to work. And I specifically remember that night I had car problems luckily somebody at the airport was able, in the parking lot, was able to help me. I got to the station probably around 10 o'clock. My shift started at midnight, but I was just like, I can't go home, or if I go home, I'm going to go to sleep. I don't want to go to sleep. So, of course, I had been up since whatever time, Sunday, to catch my flight from Chicago back to Nashville. And so, yeah, I probably didn't smell too well.
You shit your pants.
No, not that night.
Did you crap your pants?
So I'm in this, you know, production room with our program director, Bill.
It's about an 8x8 room.
And I was like, fucking Murphy. I was like, I'm so tired. I've been up all night. And Bill is so serious about thinking you're serious about whatever. And
well, you did stake that day. You did.
I did stake because you know what? We had a remote that day too.
Yeah, well, that's not an excuse.
I remember that. We had a remote that day. We went out, and I'm just like, fuck, I just want to go to bed and take a shower.
Oh, I swear to God, that was so funny.
Of course, Bill took me seriously, and I'm just like, Bill, this is a joke. And he's like, no, it's not. Tommy, Bill.
Tommy, it's a serious
Murphy
problem.
Murphy fucking with you.
Tommy, it's a serious problem. You really should put on some deodorant, go home, take a bath, you know. That hygiene thing's a big deal.
Oh, God. And because of that, what did you start calling me?
Little Stinky Tommy. It's a great name, though. It's a great name, though. Everybody, I mean, kids loved you just because of the name, because the little part. Little Stinky Tommy.
Well, because in radio, we all come up with fake names. And one of my heroes in radio was Tommy Edwards, and back at WLS, the Big 89, he was known as Little Tommy.
Yeah,
I loved that, and so I borrowed that. And then, of course, you had to enhance it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. It was enhanced, all right. Well, you got to get creative with it. You just can't steal the guy's name.
Well, yeah.
I mean, so there you go, Little Stinky Tommy. You got to make it your own. You need a t-shirt that says Little Stinky Tommy. Smell this.
Smell this.
Smell
scratch
this.
Scratch and sniff.
What does this smell like? We'll talk about trucks next time. Is it an old guy thing? Young guy thing?
It's a stupid thing.
Is it a stupid thing? And what have you forced yourself to do that was uncomfortable?
Talking to you on a podcast.
And I'm not talking about overweight women. The DOT has a weight limit, and so do I.